record on this computer. And we only have 39 slides, so that's not too bad. I did like 100 slides in radiology last week, and I was like panicked. I'm like, how in the world am I going to cover that many slides? Here's the objectives, broadly speaking. There's kind of four larger objectives here. And there might be different ones that I wrote in a little more detail in the Moodle page, but those are the objectives. So common respiratory diseases, pretty common among the population. Lots of people just from exposure, environmental exposure or history of smoking, or just genetically, you know, they're like born with asthma. Tuberculosis is not so common anymore in the US, but they're still more prevalent in other parts of the world. Chronic bronchitis, some people tend to just suffer from that more. And then pneumonias, of course, we hear about pneumonias a lot more in recent years too. And those vary. There's different kinds of pneumonias. So those are the main ones that we'll talk about. And some of these can compromise dental hygiene care. So we want to know about how we would treat these patients differently if somebody has a chronic condition or if they have an acute condition. So chronic inflammatory asthma. So we're going to start here specifically with asthma. And it's a chronic condition. It's inflammation of the respiratory system, increased response of the bronchial airways to various stimuli. So hyperreactive to certain stimuli. And that can be something like you would think would irritate physically, like pollen, but it can also be obviously like exercise induced. So you've heard that. Some people have probably experienced that. Stress, and then other things too. There can be some medications that they feel could be precipitating an attack. Particulate things that are actual like particles can irritate the bronchi and trigger an attack. So we have a whole list of things here, different things that can trigger an attack. It can be intermittent or it can be persistent. So it can be something that sort of comes and goes, or it can be something that they're experiencing like pretty consistently and have to use something on a daily basis. It's classified as mild, moderate, or severe. So it's those two categories. You can be intermittent, mild, intermittent, moderate, and then, you know, persistent, moderate, persistent, severe. So here's just a little schematic of what's happening in the lungs when somebody has an asthma attack. Everything is nice and open, and then everything kind of swells, and then there's some mucus production, thickening of the walls and the mucus production. So all of that's obviously going to make it harder to breathe and transfer the oxygen transfer. So some things you want to think about when you have a patient in your chair who has asthma, you want to ask the patient what is their triggers. It could be that it's just exercise, and that's pretty low risk, and you probably aren't going to be too concerned about that. But it could be, you know, something like a particulate matter. So then you might want to consider using the high evacuation suction. You might want to avoid, you know, air powder polish or maybe even ultrasonic. So things like that. So you just kind of talk to them about what triggers it. Ask them if they have their inhaler with them. They should really always have an inhaler, even if it's something that, you know, doesn't happen very often. If they've had an asthma attack and it, you know, was big enough to affect their comfort in breathing, then they should always have one with them. Signs and symptoms, wheezing, dyspnea, the difficulty breathing, coughing, tightness in their chest, feeling like they're suffocating. And then, of course, that's going to increase, you know, pulse and blood pressure too. And it's kind of a panicky feeling. Nobody likes to feel like they can't breathe. Asthma implications. So more implications so specifically, you're obviously, this kind of goes with asking them when they what triggers, but you want to figure out a little bit about their condition. So just figure out the parameters. It's kind of similar. You can think about it like how you think about someone with angina. You kind of want to just figure out the parameters of their condition, like what's typical for them. And that gives you a sense for how like controlled or uncontrolled they are, like what's normal for you. And hopefully they have their medications with them and all that. But so you want to talk about frequency, time of onset, you know, when was the last time that they had an asthma attack, and sort of what was it like? on what medications do they use? Have they ever been hospitalized or had to call EMS in order, to relieve the symptoms? Was it that bad? And then if they do have severe asthma, of course, you'll consult their physician and have a medical consult to make sure that it's okay for you to treat them. And then record that all if that hasn't been recorded, or update it if it hasn't been updated in a while. It's that continuity of care and continuity of notes. Like the last two hygienists that saw this patient might not have asked all these questions. So maybe they haven't been asked this stuff and they think it's kind of weird, but it's important to update that information and keep a running tab, so that the next hygienist that sees can just read from it quickly and go, oh yeah, okay, I see this is what's going on. So record and then avoid any precipitating factors. So anything that they kind of allude to could trigger them, or that has triggered them in the past, make sure and avoid. And then make sure they have their inhaler, avoid the air powder polisher, or aerosols can precipitate an attack. So anything that could create more of an aerosol. So that's why you might need to avoid the ultrasonic. Depending, use high evacuation and pre-procedural rinse. We do that on everybody, so you don't have to really think of that as anything special, but just to cut down on the bacterial load in their mouth, just for the same reason we do it for everybody. Possibly avoid epinephrine. Local anesthetics has sulfite preservatives, and that's thought to precipitate, trigger some people's asthma attacks. So not everybody. So you could ask them, you could say, have you had local anesthetic with epinephrine before, and did it bother you? Or you could look back in the chart, and if they have had it before and it was totally fine, then you can continue to use it. But that's something to like find out, so it's sort of a clarifying moment. And if they're unsure, then just use mepivacaine. It would just be easier. If there's no record and you're unsure and they don't know, just use mepivacaine. Probably be easier. So nitrous is okay for somebody with asthma, and it might be helpful to reduce stress. But if somebody is in a severe state, then that's probably something you would avoid. So if they have like severe asthma, then you wouldn't go for nitrous. And of course, you could talk to the doctor about that. Does this patient, they have mild asthma, they're a little stressed, they're worried about having a cleaning, they don't like having a cleaning. Should we use nitrous? And then you and the doctor can talk about it, and you can always call the physician too. But in general, if they're a mild to moderate and well controlled, and they know what triggers their asthma attacks, then it's probably okay to use nitrous. So then some other things to think about for somebody with asthma is, are they taking a systemic corticosteroid, such as prednisone? So if they are, there's going to be some additional things. If they're like regularly taking a steroid drug, then there's some other things to think about, such as the side effects for oral corticosteroids. Let me move my little face here so I can make sure I don't miss any of my notes. So we know that there can be some, obviously their suppression of their immune system too is something that can happen. And then stress on the adrenal gland, slower healing, higher risk to infection. So those are all those things that you sort of want to think about with somebody who could be taking it on a regular basis. Avoid, and we already said, avoid the precipitating factors during professional care. That keeps popping up. Instruct patient to bring medical inhaler. We talked about that. So inhalers can leave an unpleasant taste in the mouth after they use it, and it can also cause xerostomia. So we want to be aware of the oral manifestations or oral, side effects from using these medications, and help them sort of mitigate them or make them less severe, or reduce their caries risk if it's causing dry mouth. Children with asthma may be mouth breathers. And so with this, if they breathe from through their mouth from a young age, it can actually change the shape, can cause a more vaulted palate. They can have more inflammation in the anterior teeth. So it can actually do some like physical changes throughout their life. And then malocclusion, narrowing, there might be some overlapping of teeth. So it's important to, kind of talk about some of those risk factors with parents and see if there's something that they can do to change that while their child is still developing. Set goals with patients to maintain meticulous home care and frequent recare intervals, just like with everyone. So some of the side effects of the medications, there's a thorough table on page on table 55 and 50-1. Those are the two different chapters, I'm pretty sure. Like if you have the old edition, I think 50.50-1, is it? Let me, well, I think I was referencing edition 4 because people have had the older edition, but probably by now you all have the fifth edition. So some of the side effects of the medication: cough, hoarseness, oral candidiasis, for sure, unpleasant taste, and xerostomia. And then these are sort of relative contraindications. The textbook says contraindicated or used with caution. So I don't, you know, this is something that you'd probably be able to figure out once you talk to the patient more. But if aspirin has been known to precipitate asthma attack, NSAID, so ibuprofen, naproxen, those have been known to precipitate an asthma attack. So patients would know that. Like, you know, unless they're like a little kid who's doesn't know what they're taking, their mom just gives them stuff. Most adults would be like, "Oh, I can't take aspirin, it affects my asthma." Barbiturates and narcotics as well. And then some of these other drug interactions, which you really wouldn't, obviously you're not prescribing these, but erythromycin and ciprofloxacin, they can, there's an interaction with patients who are also taking theophylline. So, but that's, you know, you might notice that if you remember that detail, you might notice it on a medical history, but you're not going to prescribe that. So it's probably not as much of an issue. And then also, again, just with a reminder of the local anesthetic, possibly. And that's due to the sulfite. So it's not due to the epinephrine. It's total asthma and epinephrine is fine. It's the sulfite preservatives that they use in the local anesthetic. So just to remember that. So this is called an asthma spacer, and this is a helpful tool for people who have to use an inhaler on a regular basis. And what it does is it helps to push the medicine down deeper into the lungs and get it through the oral cavity faster. So it's a chamber that's attached to the mouthpiece of the inhaler that holds the discharged cloud of medication. So instead of like breathing it through the inhaler, it fills the chamber of that, and then they release it, and like they have a chance to take a really deep breath as they release it in one go. And so it just gets it deeper into the lungs, and it helps avoid some of the oral side effects, which is good. So it can help prevent the oral yeast infection, which is a big concern. Hoarse voice decreases the amount of medicine deposited in the mouth and the throat, which you don't need it in the mouth and the throat. You want it in the lungs, and help reduce xerostomia and the associated kind of downflow negative consequences of xerostomia. So that's a something I've never seen anybody use that. It may be that people use that when they use an inhaler on a daily basis, but if someone has just a rescue inhaler, maybe they're not as likely to have that with them. Obviously, that sort of would make more sense. Anybody here used one of those before or had a family member? Yeah. Who was that? In pediatrics? Oh, okay. Well, that's good to know. Okay. So then moving on from asthma, we'll go over the medications after we do COPD. We'll review the medications just a little bit too. So COPD, it's a common preventable treatable disease that's characterized by persistent respiratory symptoms and airflow limitations that's due to airway and/or alveolar abnormality. So it's not just emphysema and chronic bronchitis. I mean, you can, for the most part, people who have COPD will have those two things, but there can be you know, other little things that have happened or that they fall into little different categories, and they're still deemed chronic obstructive, you know, pulmonary disease. So it doesn't just have to be those two, but a lot of the times that's what it is. It's emphysema, a combination of emphysema and chronic bronchitis. Emphysema has become is a pathological term to describe the overinflation, or we might say hyperinflation of lungs and irreversible destruction. So they puff up and they like overfill, and then it actually destroys the little sacs. And so then they have all these areas where there's like damp permanent damage. It causes a breakdown in the walls of the alveoli, and it decreases respiratory function and, of course, difficulty breathing once you have enough damage from that. And then chronic bronchitis is inflammation of the bronchial tubes, heavy mucosa and phlegm. Somebody who has chronic bronchitis is going to be like doing that really juicy sounding cough. Heavy mucosa, phlegm can be expectorated. Chronic is persistent mucus producing cough, lasts more than 2 years for at least 3 months at a time. So it's something that just keeps coming back and it lasts a long time. That'd be chronic bronchitis. Okay, so chronic bronchitis and emphysema COPD. So the symptoms appear gradually but intensify in individuals who smoke or when there's air pollution, higher particulate matter in the air. So those things are gonna intensify the symptoms. Blue bloater is such a strange term, but that's a term used for when somebody is in a really chronic stage. Obviously, you think of blue, you think of somebody needing oxygen, right? So it's an acute attack, breathing distress, rapid labored breathing, and usually the person will start to have a blue hue, especially to like their lips and nails areas. Those are usually the first areas to start to show a physical sign of lack of oxygen and sort of turn blue, intensive coughing, and bluish skin. Emphysema can be generalized or localized. So they might just have a small area in their lung that's affected, or it can be a larger area affected. And then if it's localized and small enough, they may not notice it. There may not be symptoms because the rest of their lungs are able to function well enough so that they're not really noticing it. And it can progress really slowly or it can progress rapidly. May find it easier to breathe sitting up. So that's an important thing for you to remember as dental hygienists, that if you have a patient with COPD, even if it's mild or moderate, they might not be comfortable laying back really far. And of course, they may not be comfortable laying back really far with the ultrasonic. So those are things to think about. Advanced stages, cyanosis, so sort of that bluey lack of chronic lack of oxygen, change in mental status, headache, weakness, tremors, and twitching. So a lot of negative side effects of chronically not having enough oxygen. So big cause, people always think of cigarette smokers, air pollution and industrial fumes and dust, though. So depending on the environment of where somebody works can really can have long-term lung effects. Severe respiratory infection when somebody was young. So if they had something that was really damaging to their lungs when they were young, underdeveloped lungs, so like a preemie, premature baby, genetic predisposition. So this is a little bit complicated. I'm not going to test on this because it's I don't think we need to be tested on this alpha-1 antitrypsin, but it is kind of interesting. It's almost acts like if they have this genetic predisposition, it almost acts like an autoimmune. Like if your body doesn't make enough of this, there's a it's an ACE. It's a elastase. It's something that's naturally made in your lungs, and the alpha-1 sort of counters it. But if you don't have that from this genetic predisposition, then the elastase starts breaking stuff down in your lungs. So that's the overview of it. I wrote, there's more detail in the notes, and so you can read about it, but I'm not going to test you on that. The only thing that might come up on a test is what's a genetic predisposition, and you would just need to recognize the alpha-1 antitrypsin, but you don't have to know the function of it, like what is actually happening. But it is kind of interesting just to have that in the background, so I put it in the notes. So other things to be aware of, medications and treatments. So for chronic bronchitis, somebody may be on antibiotics, bronchodilators, inhalers, long-term oxygen, and then surgery is also possible treatment. Here's just a little picture of the damage, COPD damage in the airways and the sacs, the alveoli, the damaged walls. They just sort of lose the ability to do their function, their job, and they just kind of become large, damaged areas. And they lose elasticity, and you can't breathe, obviously, very well if they're not doing their job of expanding and contracting to help help breathe and transfer oxygen. So here's another just little diagram. COPD is progressive disease, but with early diagnosis, it can be slowed. So down, if somebody is just having some mild symptoms, of course, you're going to talk about not smoking or maybe possibly changing careers if they're working somewhere where there's toxic chemical fumes. The next step might be they might carry an inhaler with them and, you know, have a some kind of a rescue inhaler for when they need it. Inhaled corticosteroids would be a next level, a little bit more intensive treatment, pulmonary re rehabilitation, carrying around an oxygen tank, and then surgery. So that's sort of the progression of the severity. Where people live can affect them too. My dad smoked for 40 years or more, and so he's got mild COPD. And when in Maine, he had to have a inhaler, not a corticosteroid. I think he just had a bronchodilator, but he had to use it like daily in Maine. And then they moved to Arizona, and he never used it. He feels totally fine. So something about environment too can help. It's probably just because it's drier, I guess. So COPD, so some things that you need to know as a hygienist. So again, we already mentioned this, but the semi-supine to upright, depending on how severe their breathing difficulty is. Short appointments, again, depending on how severe their COPD. If it's mild, and they might not, you might not even notice anything. It might treat them like anybody else. But if it's, you know, moderate or more, then you're going to notice more of these things. Assess their severity and the frequency of how often they need to use a bronchodilator, and what exacerbates it, just like the asthma. What are their precipitating factors or things that make it worse? Thoroughly assess their health history for concurrent heart disease. So sometimes they could have like congestive heart disease or congestive heart failure or something that goes along with the COPD, especially if they smoked for a long time. The chances of them having some kind of cardiovascular disease and lung disease is, you know, that's not super uncommon. They could have both of those. Thoroughly, okay, I said that. Xerostomia, hypo or hyposalivation. So, you know, xerostomia is usually something they notice. Hyposalivation they may not notice, but they may be at higher risk for caries because they just don't have as much saliva. Are they still a smoker? What's their perio status? Of course, that goes all in the same ball of wax, right? Cardiovascular, perio, smoking, this all of these things affect each other. Oral cancer screening and then tobacco cessation. So, are they affected by periodontal disease, chronic COPD, heart disease? Do they want to quit smoking? Have they recently quit smoking? Just sort of figuring out what's going on with them. Where their state of mind is, and if they're interested, you can always just, it's one of those things where if someone's ready to quit, they're ready to talk about it. If they're not ready to quit, you can just see it written all over their face. And I've had patients dragging in their oxygen, still smoking. And you guys have probably seen that. I mean, not smoking in the dental office, but you know what I mean. You see them walk out the door and they light up. So it's a lot of times a lot harder. And that's going to be an older generation anyways. I don't think your generation, and I think smoking kind of ended around my generation. I mean, I still see people smoking, but like traditional, like old time cigarettes, but they're usually older people. Do you guys feel like you see people your age smoking real cigarettes? Like, what's that? It's not, vaping is very popular. Yeah, you see a lot of vaping. I know, I feel like traditional smoking is kind of like me, like passe, like nobody does that anymore. But I mean, there are definitely older generations, and then some, you know, you'll still see it. But they're going to find out there's probably different risks. I know there's different risks and probably different set of health problems from vaping that we'll see more and more. Okay, so they have the same people with COPD and people with asthma are going to have the same similar risk factors with the medications because a lot of the medications can be used for both. So oral candidiasis, they have an inhaler if they're on a systemic steroid. Definitely, I've italicized these. Avoid the rubber dam. So someone with COPD can't have a rubber dam. So if you see someone next semester in your spring restorative course and they have COPD on there, then you definitely you're out having to have to do a rubber dam, which I don't think you guys are doing very many. I think they're doing the isolite more. I know you're like, please never. It's easier to put a rubber dam. Everything's easier on a human. Everything's easier on a human as opposed to the type it on, I think. But somebody might argue that. And the person probably depends on the person. But when I was in it, I remember some people's teeth, like I couldn't even do the rubber dam because their teeth were so short. So the clamp wouldn't fit. So even if it was a decent, like, a person that could have a rubber dam, there'd be something else that affected it. Like, well, I can't even get the clamp to stay on the tooth because the tooth was so short. So there's just things where it just won't work. And so the isolite is better. Again, avoid powdery substances. They could be irritating, such as the air powder polisher. We do our pre-procedural rinse, use the high evacuation if that seems prudent. Avoid nitrous for emphysema. So that's a contraindication for somebody with emphysema. You're not going to use nitrous. So asthma might be okay if it's milder. Emphysema, no. Offer low flow oxygen if needed, stress reduction, just like with anything, it's just better if they're not stressed. Ask them about if they took their medications. And if they need an anti-anxiety medication that might be prescribed, that might help them feel less stressed, feel more comfortable, breathe easier. If someone's stressed, they're not going to feel like they can breathe very well. They can. Yeah, they could do a lot of times. It used to be that they'd do like Xanax or something like a benzo, but like Dr. Matsuda, he used to prescribe Halcyon. That was his go-to. And nowadays, I know that the whole environment has changed. Doctors or dentists are trying to get away from that. So whatever it's going to be like in your practice will be unique. It'll depend on the doctor's, just their outlook, their theory. But yeah, they definitely can. And they still do because you have to, like, in order to get people in the chair, sometimes you have to get them to be relaxed. And they might not want nitrous or they might not be able to use nitrous just because of the procedure. So here's a review of the medication. Some of these are a little bit more like you might remember them a little bit better than others. So I put the action down. The drug, the overall classification, the generic is not in. Are these? That's not parentheses. What are those? They are parentheses? Oh, quotation. I was thinking of quotation marks. I'm like, wait, what? Yes. So the brand name is in parentheses. So, I hate these names. I have to practice them for oral med. Fluticasone or Flovent, Flonase, that's a pretty common one, Flonase. That's anti-inflammatory. It's inhaled or it's also like spray. And so these are some adverse reactions: cough, hoarseness, oral candidiasis, unpleasant taste, and xerostomia. So those are some things to be aware with the fluticasone, fluticasone or Flovent or Flonase. Another anti-inflammatory agent would be like a prednisolone. That's a pretty common steroid, prednisolone. And this is systemic. So that's going to be a pill. So they're going to be taking that regularly. And so this is going to have some things that you really want to be aware of. If you see anything that's a salone, if you see anything like that, you know it's a steroid. Like that ending is indicative of like a steroid drug. So slower healing, infections more likely, and the symptoms of the infection, especially in the mouth, are going to be masked. If they're taking an anti-inflammatory and they have periodontal disease and gingivitis, it's going to be weird because their tissue might look great, and then you get in there and you start doing stuff and they bleed like crazy. And you're like, that's weird. Their tissue looked pink and pretty healthy, but it's from the medication. Bronchodilators, so this is a beta 2 adrenergic. It's short acting. And so this is the albuterol. This main side effect here is the xerostomia and the throat irritation. So dry mouth. So albuterol, think xerostomia, throat irritation. Here's another beta 2 bronchodilator. This one is a long acting, the Atrovent, and this one also causes xerostomia. So dry mouth, cough, hoarseness, those are some common side effects. Oral sustained release tablet or capsule. So this is going to be more long term. And I don't recognize this one. So I don't feel like I've seen this one very often. All the other ones I've seen in practice, but I haven't seen this one. So this is probably one that when you do see it, you'll just look it up. You'll be like, what was that again? I don't know. But this one has a fair amount of side effects: gastric reflux, headache, tachycardia. So increase the heart rate, insomnia, nausea, trembling, nervousness. And then this non-steroidal preventative therapy, this is the leukotriene modifier. So there's different things that they act on. This is acting on the leukotriene. So it's a selective antagonist for the leukotriene, singular. So this is one that you'd probably see that written down on somebody's medical history relatively commonly if they are taking it for asthma or COPD. And this can cause nausea, malaise, headache. And then Advair is another fairly common one, another anti-inflammatory bronchodilator. So this is a combination medication. So it's steroid and bronchodilator. So this is going to have both of the things that you'd look at for the previous slide where it said, just xerostomia for like the bronchodilator, but this will also have the bad taste, and it can have the oral candidiasis, increase of oral candidiasis, throat irritation, because this is a combination medicine. Advair. So that's kind of Advair well, Advair, Atrovent, but albuterol. Those are the three to, and singular too, but those are the three to kind of be more aware of and get them straight in your head as to which one's the combination, which one's the rescue inhaler, and then the side effects that go along with those. Okay, what time is it? We take a little break. We've only been going 40 minutes, but let's take a quick 5 minute break. I will run and grab the worksheets off of the recording. Okay, so we'll finish this up, and then we'll have plenty of time for you guys to finish up the handout. And then we might even get done a minute earlier, so that'll be nice. So tuberculosis is an airborne communicable disease. I'm gonna move my face again, hanging over my notes. That affects primarily the lungs, but remember from oral med, it can also affect other organs. So it's not, I mean, the lungs is what you always think about because we think about the coughing and the hacking and having it be like something that's airborne, but it can also affect other organs. It's the oldest disease known to strike humans. I didn't know that. That came out of the textbook, and still most widespread ailment worldwide. So even though we don't see a lot of like active tuberculosis or a lot of cases in America, there's still other countries where it's still pretty prevalent. And remember, the medications for it are like it's compliance is hard. So there can be resistant, like the bacteria can be resistant to medication because it's like 9 months of treatment and people start feeling better and then they stop taking the medication. And so there can resistance can form. But it's an airborne disease, affects primarily the lungs, can attack other organs. We already said that. Who's at risk? So People who are at risk are going to be if you're immunocompromised, if you're living in a large group home, a healthcare worker, you're just exposed more, immigrants, medically the medically underserved, infants and children, and then medically compromised or malnourished. So people who are going to be in a weaker position physically, health-wise, or if you're just exposed to it more often. So for diagnosis, there's the skin test. They just put the little tiny thing under the skin, and if you get a reaction, then it's positive. A chest X-ray or a sputum culture, and then treatment. The preventative therapy, you can have the isoniazid or rifampin for 4 to 9 months, and then multi-drug therapy, short hospital stay if you're in sort of like the acute, really trying to. Yes. That is something. Yeah, it's not there, huh? I don't know if you can diagnose. I mean, you must be able to, right? Why don't I have that there? Is that new? Is the blood test new? It newer? Yeah, let me write. I'm gonna look into that and then I'll update it. Because I feel like Allison just sent out something. Centauro sent out something about the blood test being an option. But yes, I do believe so, Anna, that that's another way to diagnose that. I need a piece of paper. Okay. So things to be aware of for TB, disease transmission is the greatest concern. So obviously, if somebody is in an active state of tuberculosis, you're not going to want them in the chair. That's the biggest concern. Other than that, somebody could have like a latent, they could have tuberculosis and have no symptoms. And so it's one of those things where you might not even know that the person in the chair has it unless they said, I had tuberculosis and I've been through treatment, or they self-disclose. Other than that, you might have no clue unless they're actively like really coughing a whole bunch. Standard, so that's why we have standard infection control. I mean, that's sort of the same reason when the whole AIDS epidemic came up, and it's like, well, no, if you just have standard precautions for everybody and you treat everybody like they have some horrible disease, then you're gonna protect yourself. And so we just do the same thing for everybody. Because somebody may be in your chair that has tuberculosis with no symptoms, but not as common. Recognizing the signs and symptoms, if positive, record their test results, the dates when a chest X-ray was taken, and follow-up medical appointments. Now we just talked about this. I should have had it pulled up. And I think they just changed it in the clinic manual. I think it, what is it, like 10 years? If they said that they had tuberculosis and they had it treated, say, in another country, and they don't have any records, but it's been like 10 years, then we can still see them. We talked about it in the faculty, and I should want to get out of this and see if I can pull it up really, really fast to see how it how the wording was changed in the clinic manual. Unless somebody remembers off the top of their head. And so then they were just like, okay. Oh, really? Okay, let me look. I'm in the clinic manual. Just let me do control find. Everything is moving like super slow. Tuberculosis. Tuberculosis protocol, page 55. Let's see. Oh, for heaven's sake. Persons in fact, okay, so they're talking about the high-risk groups in the manual. Iris groups, dental management. This is okay, this is highlighted. Obtain a medical clearance, history of a negative chest X-ray from a physician or clinic prior to proceeding with dental treatment, if reported within the last 10 years. If the patient reports it's been longer than 10 years since the diagnosis, proceed with treatment as long as the patient is symptom-free of clinically active disease. So if they say, yeah, 12 years ago I had tuberculosis and they don't have any records and they're symptom-free, you can proceed. But if it's been 10 years or less, I guess they must have been right on the cutoff, then if they don't have, then they have to bring in like a chest X-ray or something. Because they were like, yeah. Yeah. Go get a chest. It seems a little, even 10 years seems like a really long time to me. I'm thinking like 5 to 7, but I guess they're just trying to be really safe. But so that's, so if it's been more than 10 years, they don't need to kind of prove like a clear chest X-ray. If it's been 10 years or less, they have to prove like that they don't have active TB. Okay, I'm gonna go back where I was here. Okay. Consult with a physician if they're safe to treat. If you're unsure, instruct client to practice cough etiquette while in the office. And then cough etiquette is moving away from people, always washing your hands after you cough. So that's all for tuberculosis, kind of just a quick overview of that. And then we'll move on here to pneumonia. So pneumonia is an inflammation of the gas exchanging units of the lungs. And that inflammation is caused by microorganisms such as it can be bacterial, it can be fungi, or it can be viral. So it can be any of those, and as well as the aspiration of a chemical irritant. So that can cause inflammation as well. So lots of different sources that can contribute to pneumonia. And here's just kind of a little image that shows the normal sacs, and then here they get all fluid filled. And so, of course, if they're filled with fluid, it can't exchange the oxygen as well and the gases. So there's two main types of pneumonia. There's CAP, which is community-acquired pneumonia, and then there's nosocomial. So those are your two main types, and then there's subtypes under the nosocomial, which we'll talk about too. But for the community-acquired, this is the most common one, like out in the general population. The pathogens that normally reside in the oropharyngeal mucosa, bacterial infections are the cause of over 50%. So a lot of times people have bacterial pneumonia. They can obviously be treated with an antibiotic for that. And then viruses account for about 40%, and then there can be a mix. So that's why sometimes, like if you have viral pneumonia, they can't really do much for you unless they give you an antiviral or a steroid or an anti-inflammatory. Like there's, they might treat it in other ways, but some of that was the initial difficulty with COVID, right? Because it's like a viral pneumonia. But they found some treatments there. But that's, and but if it's bacterial, then they know that they can treat with an antibiotic. For the nosocomial pneumonias, there's three types. There's hospital acquired, there's ventilator associated, and then there's healthcare associated. So all of these are sort of acquired, like in an abnormal, it's not just because you were out amongst people and you got sort of a common virus that's floating around or a bacteria or something. So they're different spectrum of organisms, not normally found in the oropharynx. Commonly are multi-drug resistant because they kind of happen a lot in a similar environment, and so they're resistant to medications and develop resistance easily to certain antibiotics, and so sometimes they're more difficult to treat. Frequently prolonged hospital stays increases healthcare costs and causes death, especially in the elderly and the immunocompromised. So, you know, like the classic story is, you know, like my grandma broke her hip, or my grandma or grandpa went into the hospital for this and that, and they died in the hospital with pneumonia. So that was like hospital acquired pneumonia that took them out. And it was due to being in the hospital. And so that's kind of a sad, and that happens in community homes, it happens in hospitals, and it does tend to affect the elderly a lot more. So aspiration pneumonia, the first one, it's most often associated with the elderly, aspiration of oral microorganisms. And this can happen a lot of times. The mouth is not very clean, like especially if somebody, you guys already know this from working your rotations at the assisted living, there can be a lot more bacteria, a lot more plaque. And they can also suffer from dysphagia a lot more, weakness in their swallowing, weakness in their throat. So they might aspirate, food or saliva or something with bacteria from the mouth, and then it can cause pneumonia. So elderly patients and those with dysphagia are more prone to aspiration pneumonia. Proper oral hygiene has been showed to help. So that's why going into these nursing homes and even just doing a chlorhexidine swab and a debridement, you don't even have to do like a full-on scaling and root planing. It lowers the bacteria and it reduces their risk of having aspiration pneumonia. It's really important. Ventilator associated is kind of self-explanatory. If somebody's been vented, if they're on a ventilator, then bacteria or microorganisms can build up on the part that's that they put down their throat. So a patient free of pneumonia on a hospital admission, so they come in with no pneumonia, they've been medically ventilated for at least 48 hours, and then they develop pneumonia, then they consider that ventilator associated pneumonia. A biofilm is thought to develop on the endotracheal tube, and it migrates down into the lower airways. And it introduces the pathogens down there. It's difficult to perform oral hygiene. It's really hard to clean somebody's teeth when they're ventilated, but they do have kits that you can use. They have them at the hospital, at least they should, and they swab out their mouths. They can't use a lot of like liquid or anything, but you can use like antibacterial, chlorhexidine, like the swabs. That's the most common, and they have to do it pretty frequently to keep the bacterial load down. And it may, of course, delay regular oral hygiene regimen. If they're ventilated, they're not going to be getting their teeth brushed and flossed probably as normally. I mean, absolutely not. But yeah, highlight. Yeah, just the biofilm in our mouths. And like we know from biofilm, like the longer you leave a colony of bacteria undisturbed, it becomes more and more complex and more virulent. And so that can happen. So if they're just laying there, not, and those bacterial colonies are never disrupted, they become just like more, yeah, more and more complex and more intertwined, and they set up a better and better home and colony, and then that can build up on the tube, on the ventilator, and then it can migrate down. So it's not like it's a guaranteed thing to happen, but that's what their theory is, or the hypothesis is, that they're prone to that because of the buildup of bacteria. So yeah, it'd be just regular oral bacteria. So prevention of pneumonia, so proper oral care for the elderly or the infirm or somebody who's intubated patient, it's critical to prevent pneumonia among these groups. Emphasize importance of proper oral care to the family members. So if somebody's coming in, say somebody's on a ventilator and somebody's coming in, a family member, like, you can like relay that message, like make sure a nurse or somebody's coming in and swabbing. And if they're too busy and they're not doing it, ask them how and let me do it. Like family members can kind of advocate. And the same thing in nursing homes. It's sad. It just doesn't happen as much as it should. But if the family members know how important that is and that it can actually reduce their chances of having like aspiration pneumonia. There are oral kits, like I said, that are commercially available to use for intubated patients, and just brushing teeth and using chlorhexidine swabs. There's also like the suction toothbrush. It's like a little suction machine with a toothbrush on the end. And that's really good for elderly people or somebody who's, has some kind of a condition where they need, full care, or if somebody's intubated. So just some recommendations: remove the denture daily, refrain from wearing the denture at night. They should take out their denture. And if they have dementia or they're, older, and they might just be more comfortable with their denture in their mouth, or they might just forget and not think that it's a big deal. And so that's why people need to kind of help them, family members and the nursing staff, to help them take it out at night, rinse, soak it. Brush floss, use interdental cleaners once per day. For ventilated, why do I have 17 there? That's funny. know what that 17 is supposed to do. For ventilated patients, I have no idea what 17 is. Pooling of secretions should be minimized through regular drainage and suction. So just helping, like if they're ventilated, they're obviously not going to be swallowing. And so they need, you know, like a they need help with all of that. And so that's not really lies on us, but that's just things to be aware of. Especially there is opportunity. Here's another example of like interprofessional. There are hygienists who work in hospitals, and these are the types of patients they would see. Would be cancer patients in hospitals, intubated patients in hospitals. And so there's more of this. There's the National Healthcare. Oh, I wish I had the name of it. Maybe I'll try and remember to bring it to next class. But there's an association that just got started a couple of years ago, like 2 years ago, and their whole goal is to give hygienists like a certificate for that basically they're trying to like create this environment where hygienists are trained to be able to work in medical environments. So there's one for cancer, there's one for like someone who wants to work in the hospital or OBGYN, and they're called the National Healthcare Hygienist or National. Yes, that's probably it. Is it blue?
Is it like a blue?
Yeah. National Network of Healthcare Hygienists. And you can go in there and you can pay. I was a member for like 2 years and then I stopped my membership. But it was only $11 a month. And then I don't know if it's the same, but you can go in there and you can pay for a whole certification. And they're really trying to get hygienists out of just the tradition, not all hygienists, but to get people hygienists who want to be out of the regular operatory and into hospitals or into medical offices to like integrate. So that's a really good resource. Thank you. I will either I'll put it in a slide or something next time so we can see that. So patient's head should be elevated. So if you are working on somebody who is intubated or an elderly person, these are just some basics. Elevating their head, using a toothbrush or a foam swab. Like I said, there's those suction toothbrushes. And the oral cavity should be de debrided frequently, especially if they're intubated. Emphasize importance of proper oral care to family members or caregivers and ensure access to oral care products. Okay, last section here, we're going to go over. So this isn't necessarily thought of in like the same category as like asthma. Or you know, pneumonia or something, but the sleeping disorders, or sleep-related breathing disorders. So here's a little sort of a spectrum of how somebody might be considered. If you just snore, you might not be considered to actually have like a breathing disorder or a disease. But if you go into this spectrum where you start to actually have hypopnea or apnea, like where you're actually not breathing for a certain amount of time, then you're going to be considered to be into this obstructive sleep apnea and disease. So there's a range of breathing abnormalities from chronic to habitual snoring for various types of sleeping disease. So snoring is pretty common, but it kind of crosses a threshold. And even they'll say snoring in and of itself is not like normal, like nobody should snore, but it's just a lot of people do snore. And we have a Capstone group who's doing this to try and see possibly to increase the screening and clinic for this, which is very exciting because I think this is a subject we don't have enough information about for our patients. So that will be really exciting. So obstructive sleep apnea. So these are just two. This is an image of a CPAP machine. This is sort of the gold standard. It's the positive airflow that's people have to wear it all night long to keep oxygen flowing, or else their brain might just not be telling them to breathe, or it could be that they're physically obstructed from like their tongue or something like that. But this positive airflow keeps oxygen flowing. And then this is just kind of showing how some physical structures in the body can kind of collapse backwards and cause a physical obstruction. So why they will go into these moments of not breathing. So OSA or obstructive sleep apnea, it's a condition that involves the partial or complete collapse of the upper airway while breathing during sleep. It's characterized by loud snoring and periods of breathing cessation. So like stopping breathing or awakening or a choking sensation. Has anybody had a choking sensation and woken up from that? Me too. Yeah. You've witnessed it? I haven't had it like regularly, but I have experienced it, and it's freaky. Right, you think, I know. But sometimes it really does have to do with just the size of like your tonsils or something maybe in your nasal path. I mean,
But like my surgeon, she was like, "Oh my gosh, you're giving me this person like I'm offering not," and then she found
Yes.
out. And I was like, "Why would you tell me that right before you're about to offer not?"
I've never
But
seen
yeah, I
anyone
had
so
to get
young.
my I was young. I remember I used to wake up like that forever. And like I was sleeping. And like I was like, when you're sleeping but you're trying to get yourself up, it was like that. And I was literally just like, yeah,
That
I
is
was
such a not a
scared.
good feeling. Then you'd be scared to fall asleep.
Yeah.
Oh, that's terrible. My sister had her adenoids taken out for similar sleeping issues. I don't know why they did adenoids instead of tonsils, but they did her adenoids. But yeah, it's that's a not a pleasant feeling. Causes a decrease in atrial oxygen, which is no good. Mild, so there's different categories. You can be mild obstructive sleep apnea, moderate, severe, depending on how frequently you stop breathing. So because I had to read so many articles and I still have more to read from my Capstone group, it's like if you do up to five in an hour, is that what it said? Then that is then that's you're kind of crossing the threshold. If you stop breathing up to five times in an hour, you cross the threshold into sleep apnea. So they have to do like a sleep study in order to kind of see where you fall. Has been associated with metabolic, so that's like pre-diabetes, so metabolic conditions, so pre-diabetes, cardiovascular, and respiratory disorders. So some oral manifestations, and I think this whole presentation will become much more thorough after this year with, but so some, just to overview the topic, some oral manifestations associated with sleep apnea. Extra oral features including retrognathic mandible, so a small mandible, often accompanied by a class two malocclusion. So you think of like that kind of retro, the mandible going backwards, increased anterior height, so like a vaulted palate, and then resulting in a long looking face and decreased nasal passage. So I was just, my Lola wakes up stuffy every morning, and I see her mouth breathing at night, and I'm trying to like wrap my mind around what I should start doing. I mean, she's four, and she wakes up with like this morning I was like, plug this nostril, now breathe, and it was really clogged, and then this one she like was whistling, and then and she wants to breathe through her mouth, like she's always just, and I'm like, no, you're supposed to breathe through your mouth, but she's clogged up all the time. So she could just have allergies, I don't know, but I have to start addressing it now because she's four and I don't want her to do that forever. But anyway, so bruxism while sleeping can result in notable attrition, possible leading to exposed dentin, abfractions, and tooth fractures. This fascinates me because I've bruxed my teeth my whole life. I got flat teeth. And so, and I have had those choking sensations. So I've been fascinated with that combination. So if you see somebody with heavy wear, you know, there's gonna be certain signs and things that you can look at that might trigger your thought of maybe this person has a sleeping disorder or a sleep apnea. Anterior wear due to positioning of the mandible forward, they're trying to open up their airway. So if there's a lot of heavy wear on the front, it might be them like constantly bringing their mandible forward when they sleep. An enlarged tongue, scallop borders. Acid erosion on the lingual surfaces of teeth due to acid reflux, which may occur with patients attempt to breathe during an apnea event. So acid reflux, grinding, apnea, these all are sort of kind of in this, they're all sort of thinking about these and how they affect each other, which is really interesting. Enlarged tonsils, edema, erythema of the soft palate. So if somebody has a very red, soft palate, if their tonsils are huge, you're practically touching each other on either side. surrounding structures that may indicate snoring or sleep apnea. Red and edematous gingival tissue, particularly in the anterior, that can be a sign of mouth breathing due to a sleep related disorder. Constricted maxillary and mandibular arches can crowd the tongue and may result in tongue being more posterior in the mouth, further blocking the airway from the patient. Somebody has really, really big mandibular tori. Their tongue can't rest in the floor of their mouth. And so when they lay back, their tongue can just fall to the back of their mouth. So if they have certain structures, you know, or a narrow arch and big tori, I mean, there's all these different things that can attribute to it. Abnormal enlargement of the tonsils, along with constricted arches, particularly in children, often contributes to sleep-related breathing disorders. So apnea is the actual cessation of breathing, most often caused by excessive weight and obesity, nasal congestion, smoking, excessive alcohol use. If someone's a heavy drinker right before bed, in children, enlarged tonsils are a major causative factor. Tumor or birth defects involving the tongue, mandible can be contributing factors. So there's a range of different reasons that somebody can have sleep apnea. Well, that's a good question. I think that that's what, like, part of the capstone is to actually open that up to more, like, actually have a protocol for when you see large tonsils, when you see signs of wear, when you ask them if they're fatigued and if they feel tired during the day, or does their partner complain that they snore, and then what's the protocol? Because we don't really have one in our clinic. So really, you could talk to the doctor, the dentist, and you could say, you know, just while I was doing the EO, at this point for you guys practically for this year, you can say, I've seen these things. And you might even talk to your patient and see, you know, what they say. And then the doctor could refer them to their physician and say, you know, you might actually want to see about having a sleep study or talk to your physician, because you have some signs of possible sleep apnea that can affect your overall health. You know, it can affect your heart long term. It's actually pretty serious. And so, but we don't want to, you know, freak anybody out. But you know, just to let them know that they seem like they could be at high risk. So if I were you, I would get anything that you see that kind of raises a red flag, just make note of it and then talk to the dentist about it, and then let the doctor refer them to their physician, just because we don't really have a protocol very well set up, which we should. So loud chronic snoring, or snoring followed by periods of silence that may indicate apnea, the kind of gasping after they go quiet. Awakening occurring with sounds of snorting, gasping, choking. Their quality of life changes that may involve physical, psychological, and occupational limitations, including social interactions. It's amazing people who,
And that's why I asked about it, because
it is. Yeah, I think so too. It's like one more thing. And I think a lot more people have different levels of it, you know, different severities.
Yeah, I can say that there were three different departments made it, like, range in the house.
Yes, it can easily get, like, you're like, somebody else will deal with that. But that's why hygienists are at such a great, I mean, we are looking at those physical abnormalities or physical things in somebody's throat and mouth, and you know, that could, and then if we ask just a few simple questions, that could really start the ball rolling. And then, you know, once their physician knows that that's an issue, then they could take it from there. But yeah, definitely, because I think it's one of those things that can get, like, the ball gets passed, like you said, whose scope of practice, someone else is going to can figure that out, but it affects their overall health. But yeah, people who have who have sleep apnea and who have been like kind of living with it, and then they get on a CPAP or something like that, and all of a sudden they're getting good sleep. It is seriously life-changing. Both my in-laws have it, and my father-in-law started his CPAP when he was in his 40s, and he said it was just night and day. And my mother-in-law just started hers a couple years ago, like 2 years ago, but she started getting TMJ problems right after she started using the CPAP. And so then, and she didn't like it. She just didn't like the CPAP. And so then she went and got one of the mouth devices that pulls your mandible forward. And I don't even know if she's very compliant with that either. So I don't know. She's not as good of a compliant patient, but she did say she felt a lot better initially. Other symptoms related to decreased oxygen levels, sleep disturbances include headaches, xerostomia, and depression. Lots of things will be affected. If you're not sleeping well, oh my Lord, lots of things can be affected. So implications for us, assess for and record any extraoral and intraoral signs and symptoms of sleep-related disorder. So just do your best to kind of record what you see. Further question the patient regarding sleep habits, any medical interventions previously discussed. If no current treatments, then you can make the proper referral to just refer them back to their physician, or if there's a sleep dentist, sleep medicine place that you know of, encourage patients to be compliant with physician or other healthcare providers' recommendations. You can reiterate that importance of the systemic health for and why it's important for them to be using whatever they've been prescribed. And then if being treated with a CPAP or a BiPAP device, encourage patients to ensure proper humidification of and care of the device. It can like grow bacteria and all kinds of things. My father-in-law has to like do a whole like cleansing thing because it can get nasty. They need to like keep up on the care of it and follow those instructions. Identify signs of xerostomia and other oral manifestations. Educate the patients about conditions that may result from xerostomia. So here is one of the easy screening, which you guys kind of do anyways when you tell your patients to say, and you're looking at their tonsil. But the Mallampati score, if you can see down past the uvula, you can see it's not touching. Like you can see all of the uvula, then that's nice and open, plenty of space, and that's one. If you can see the uvula, but you can't see the end of it, then that's a little bit more obstructive, but it's still considered normal. These are still in a normal range, and these are more abnormal. If you can't see the uvula, and if you or just barely can see some opening past the soft palate, and then this is just totally closed. These are more abnormal and would be more concerning that somebody could possibly have a higher risk for sleep apnea. And then these are some other physical signs that we already kind of said, xerostomia, bruxism, if the patient self-discloses that they have a lot of sleepiness. You might need to use, if they fall asleep easily in your chair, which I can't tell you how many patients I had that would fall asleep on me, then you want to use a ligated bite block, which you guys have probably already had to do. Nutritional counseling might come into play. Limiting alcohol, like use talking to them about how alcohol, especially like if they drink and then pass out or something, how that could not be good for them. And then on many levels, and then refer to a physician or a sleep specialist. So just some basics there. So just to talk about the treatments really quickly, there's the CPAP, which is the continuous pressure. So it's just a continuous, just like it says, pressure of oxygen going through the machine. And then there's the BiPAP, which is the bi-level positive airway pressure. So it just works a little bit differently. These devices opens up the airway during sleep. So it kind of stimulates for you to stay open. We'll probably have to, I don't go into it too much because I don't actually know the super details, but there is two different kinds. Like if somebody's brain shuts off and says like, I'm just not going to breathe anymore, that's different and like far more serious because they need a different kind of treatment than if it's just a physical, you know, like large tonsil, small opening or, you know, something like that. Usually those things are far more treated easily with either a mouth device or the CPAP. But if they have something where their brain literally stops them from breathing, then they have to have a CPAP, and the mouth guard that pulls their mandible forward isn't going to probably be enough, or they may need end up needing surgery or something. So these are a couple more examples of the oral appliances. So patient can choose this primary treatment option, unable to tolerate the CPAP, or if they refuse to use the CPAP. So it's kind of like my mother-in-law. I think she was supposed to use a CPAP, but she wasn't being very compliant. So then she got one of these. Hers looks kind of like this, I think. And they can adjust the forwardness of the mandible so it can be adjusted. And they can also adjust the height of how vertical your opening is. And it's obviously more comfortable if you have a smaller opening. And then of course, if you're not pulled too far forward, because what can happen is you can get some pain in the TMJ, and then patients need to readjust in the morning. Like they have to, usually they have another splint that like readjusts them back to a normal bite. The other option, and I've never seen this one, and this just seems highly uncomfortable, is one of these little suction things that pulls the tongue forward. So you stick your tongue in there and it pulls your tongue forward so it doesn't fall back and close your airway. Oral appliances, they exert their effects by mechanically increasing the volume of the upper airway. In the retropalatal or retroglossal area, there's the mandibular advancement, that's these, and then there's the tongue retaining, and that's these. And I don't think these are as popular. I think these are far more common. And then, of course, like I said, adverse effects, TMJ pain, muscular pain, tooth pain, hypersalivation, TMJ sounds, clicking and crackling, dry mouth, gum irritation, and then morning after occlusal changes. Usually if they give you what they oftentimes do is they'll make a splint of your natural normal bite, and you take out your oral appliance and you put that splint in, and it takes just a few minutes for your muscles to relax back into your natural bite. So you have to wear that in the morning for like 10 minutes or something like that. And then you'll relax back into your bite. So that's all we have on that. Any more questions there at all? Or okay. So I'm going to stop the recording, and then we have, how much time do we have? So just a little bit more time to work on the sheet. Did everyone get one of these? No, it doesn't look like it. So just go ahead and grab one and pass it around. You guys, and if you're done, just make a pile of them. Yeah, did you guys get one of these? I love that color. You have like all the bright fun colors. I was going to tell you, so like with the heat map machine, you're like, you know how like they have to like come and support your way. And if they broken the bone or like stop somehow, or then my partner had it, so, and then like he got diagnosed and he's about to be permanent.
Yeah, but
So what did we say, Linda's not here?
Yeah. Are those two? Yeah, we used to be raptors.
Oh my word, I've been recording this full time. I'll just cut off the end of this.
All right, good birds are there.